Oh, I think we should ask all the participants to mute themselves and also to switch off their video. Only when it is required, they switch it on. Otherwise, it will interfere with the program. Can you, Rohit, can you give me names of few doctors who have come? I think it is one Dr. Bhattacharya is there, Ashok is there, Aravind is there, Rajesh is there. Can you give me the names of few more people? Am I audible?
Sir, slightly little louder you need to speak. You need to come closer, I think.
Okay. Am I audible now?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yeah, okay. Better than earlier, sir.
Mahesh?
Okay, right?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, Mahesh, there is a video on of Dr. Ashok, I guess. Could you just put it off?
Done.
Okay.
Hello, Ronak?
Yes, sir.
Ronak, Rohit here. I'm just calling you.
Okay. Mahesh, can you make me the co-host, please?
I think it's time we can start, Ronak.
Yeah. Rohit? I think, shall we start? Okay, good.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, good evening, doctors. First of all, let me welcome each one of you from Lupin. And I am very pleased to have with us Dr. Rajan Manjuran, who is one of the very elite faculties what we have in India today. Doctor has been in service for close to 45 years. Out of that 25 years, he has dedicated himself in the field of teaching cardiology student. And I think this is a wonderful opportunity to have doctor in the midst of us so that he can actually value add the upcoming students to a great extent. And a lot of the queries what you have, which you find in your daily curriculum, can get cleared over here. as you know about Lupin, Lupin is there in almost 95 odd countries. And in among all the therapy areas where we are present, cardiology, we are one of the leading houses. And one of our major initiatives, what we always do, is to drive the academic initiatives across the world, and India being the host country, you know, we always dedicate ourselves more so here. So this is basically, you know, keeping that objective in mind of ours, we have decided to start up this program, and I am extremely thankful to Dr. Rajan Manjuran, who has accepted this on our behalf. And thank you, doctor, for being a part of the program. And I'm sure this will be value add students for a long period of time. So before you start, I'll request Ronak, please share the, you know, what are the rules actually in which, you know, the program can be run.
Well, Junaid sir, thank you very much. I would like to welcome all the doctors and the faculties coming in. There are a few rules and regulations which we'll be following for this particular session. Is that first, the videos would be off during the session. Second thing, you will have to be on mute. Third thing is, whenever you have a question, you will have to first raise your hand, and Dr. Rajan will be telling you to unmute yourself and switch on your video and ask the questions. In case if there's any doubt, please just put up your question in the chat box. My technical team would get in touch directly if there's any clarification or any glitches happening. Any doubts, then you can directly get in touch with Mr. Mayes, who's from the technical team, or Mr. Rohit. Sir, Junaid sir, anything you want to add on in this?
No, that's it. Thank you.
Rohit, only problem is that can you make it such that when a student has a doubt to raise, he can unmute himself and switch on his video, raise his hand, and then he can ask a question.
Sir, it can be done.
Okay. Then one more thing is there. See, in between my presentation, I would like to ask in between few questions to the participants. They must be able to answer those questions. Then only it becomes more interactive.
Okay, sir.
Okay, let's see. When it goes, we'll know how we can.
No,
because if somebody is willing to answer, they can unmute themselves and switch on their video and then answer the question.
Sure. Okay. So thank you very much. As requested, would request all of the faculties and doctors to switch off their videos and put yourself on mute. Dr. Rajan will be starting with this presentation shortly. Thank you very much.
Okay. My dear young doctors, good evening. It gives me great pleasure in welcoming you all to the first web postgraduate teaching program of Cardiology Academy. I thank Messrs. Lupin Pharmaceuticals, especially Junaid Kurula of the CVN division, for arranging this program. This program aims to train each one of you in cardiac physical diagnosis, electrocardiographic analysis, X-ray evaluation, echocardiogram assessment, hemodynamic interpretation, pressure tracing understanding, and angiographic diagnosis. All that is required for you to sail through the final practical examination. In addition to the above, we will have short sessions on cardiac CT and cardiac MRI, as these modalities of investigations are finding greater and greater use in our day-to-day cardiac diagnosis. The pattern I propose to follow is to explain to you initially how there can be a stepwise approach to clinical diagnosis. It's very important for you to think stepwise so that you come to the correct clinical diagnosis. In subsequent classes, we shall try to apply this approach to arrive at a clinical diagnosis in various clinical scenarios, both real as well as virtual. some of the points of discussion, especially today, will be repetitions for you. However, here and there, you can definitely pick up some jewels and pearls which will ultimately help you to reach the final diagnosis and the final destination, that is passing the final examination. During my deliberations, if any point is not clear to any one of you, you can unmute your audio, switch on video, raise your hand and ask your doubt so that it can be clarified immediately. Similarly, I would like to make this an interactive session. For this, I need your participation. I would like to have at least few volunteers who can take part in the discussion. I have got the names of you, Dr. Bhattacharya, Dr. Ashok, Dr. Aravind, Dr. Rajesh, or some more who have joined can always become a part of the discussion. After a few sessions, we shall have your feedback and suggestions to make this whole program most beneficial to you. With these introductory remarks, let us get to the ball rolling. Please switch off the video and mute yourself so that my talk will be more clear to each one of you. Thank you for patient listening. Now I will go to our teaching session. Are you able to see the
yes sir
slide very well? Okay,
yes sir.
So today I will be discussing how can we have a stepwise approach to cardiac clinical diagnosis. Am I audible also? Some lines came in, I don't know.
Some lines have come in between.
What are those lines? Okay.
Yeah, it's gone, sir.
Oh, God. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's fine. Okay. Now, see, the cardiac clinical diagnosis, if you plan a stepwise approach, I would say there are 5 steps. It starts with first contact with the patient, history taking, symptom analysis, physical examination, and analysis of signs. On the first contact with the patient itself, you should start thinking about the possible diagnosis. If the patient is 0 to 5 years, if there is a heart lesion, most likely it will be a congenital heart disease. 5 to 10 years, most likely congenital heart disease, sometimes rheumatic heart disease also may come in this age group. 10 to 15 years, 10 to 30 years, rheumatic heart disease becomes a major etiology in our country. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, endomyocardial fibrosis in certain parts of our country, especially in Kerala, aorta arthritis, mitral valve prolapse, atrial septal defect, constrictive pericarditis, and some of the mild congenital heart disease like small VSD, bicuspid aortic valve, all can be present, can be detected at 10 to 30 years of age. When it goes to the next stage, 30 to 60 years, you must start thinking of coronary artery disease, systemic hypertension. Some of the patients in this group might have undergone a surgery, post-valve or congenital heart disease surgery patients, patients with myxomas, and of course, ASD also comes in this group. When it comes to 60 to 75 years, you should start thinking about coronary artery disease, definitely calcific aortic stenosis. This is the age in which calcific degenerative aortic stenosis patients will come to us. Atrioventricular blocks, AV blocks, especially degenerative AV blocks, Lennox-Gray's disease or Lev's disease can present at this age. When it comes above the age of 75 years, most of the patients come, they may have a heart lesion and they might have developed a complication. For example, one of the major complications that can precipitate symptoms is development of atrial fibrillation. My patient with systemic hypertension, who has been doing very well, may develop atrial fibrillation and may become symptomatic. So very often above the age of 75 years, you must think of a complication which has happened on a basic heart lesion. Sex, male sex, more often aortic disease, valve disease, or coarctation. All aortic diseases are more common in males. Coronary artery disease, in the cyanotic congenital heart disease, transposition of great arteries is more common in males. Patent ductus arteriosus is more common in males. When it comes to females, mitral stenosis, pulmonary stenosis, aortic arthritis, atrial septal defect, these are more common. So whenever you start seeing the patient, you should start thinking. Then there is you must look at external evidence of internal disease. For example, Down syndrome is associated with total AV canal defect, single atrium. Rubella syndrome is associated with patent ductus arteriosus, peripheral pulmonary artery stenosis, pulmonary stenosis, atrial septal defect. Turner syndrome, coarctation of aorta, bicuspid aortic valve. Noonan's syndrome, dysplastic pulmonary valve stenosis, atrial septal defect. Marfan syndrome, aortic regurgitation, mitral regurgitation, aortic dissection. Williams syndrome, supravalvular aortic stenosis, peripheral pulmonary artery stenosis. Finger abnormalities are associated with ventricular septal defect. Forearm abnormalities, Holt forearm syndrome, atrial septal defect. Edwards associated with VSD, patent ductus arteriosus, valve dysplasias. Tuberous sclerosis, patients can have a risk of developing rhabdomyomas. Leopard syndrome, the patients can present with pulmonary stenosis, subaortic stenosis. Osler-Rendu-Weber syndrome, these patients can have higher risk of developing pulmonary artery venous fistulas. Dijor syndrome, tetralogy of Fallot, truncus arteriosus. Osteogenesis imperfecta, aortic regurgitation. Mucopolysaccharidosis, valvular regurgitation. Mostly aortic valve, but they can have mitral also, mostly aortic valve. So, external evidence of internal disease can be observed by seeing the patient. Mainly look for hypertelorism, webbing, then loss at ears. You can look at the facial abnormalities and suspect the syndrome, and you can also think about the associated congenital heart disease. Then history taking. There are a few points which students should remember how to take a good story. A good history is extremely important if you want to make a correct diagnosis. Sometimes history is the only clue to the diagnosis. Example, patients with effort angina. They may not have anything else. Everything will be normal. But history of classical effort angina will make you that this patient is having coronary artery disease, chronic coronary artery disease, effort angina. So a good history is extremely important. And good history taking is an art. It is essential for an accurate diagnosis. And I will touch upon some very important points in good history taking. The first point is to establish a relationship with the patient. The patient is new to you. When the patient comes to a doctor, the patient is extremely anxious. He is worried whether he is having a disease which can ultimately result in a fatal outcome. So they are very anxious. It is our duty to make him comfortable by asking few questions. You can ask him, what is your name? So where are you from? Are you married? Have you got children? what are your children doing? So, two, three questions to familiarize you with the patient. Then ask the patient, what is your problem? Allow the patient to narrate his symptoms. Some of the intelligent patients might have come noting down the symptoms he is having, and they may read and describe very clearly their symptoms, their duration, and without any difficulty. As long as the patient is talking to you and describing the symptoms, you should carefully listen. One of the very important points in listening to the patient is that if the patient has described a symptom, you should not ask whether are you having this symptom. For example, the patient has described that he's having breathlessness. After the story, you should not go and ask, are you having breathlessness? That will create a very bad impression on the patient. The patient will start thinking that this doctor is not listening to what I have described. So you should be very careful to comprehend as well as listen to the symptoms described by the patient. Once the patient's narration is over, then you have to tackle a few things. One, you have to ask few questions to get more details of the symptom the patient has described. For example, the patient might have described that he is having breathlessness, but you would like to know whether the patient is having paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. He might have had one or two episodes of paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, which he might have forgotten. So you have to clearly ask, are you having, describe and find out whether he is having a paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. You may also like to know whether he is having a rest, breathlessness. You may also like to know how the breathlessness started. Did it have an acute onset or it gradually progressed? So you may have to ask few questions to get more details about the symptoms the patient has described. Next, you have to ask questions about symptoms which the patient has not mentioned, which have relevance to the cardiac diagnosis. For example, a patient with primary pulmonary arterial hypertension may have a prominent symptom of exertional breathlessness. The patient might have forgotten that about a year ago he had two episodes of exertional syncope. So it is your duty to ask the patient symptoms which he has not described, whether he is having that symptom. Sometimes the patients who have a very prominent symptom like breathlessness may forget the symptom of cardiac pain. So it's extremely important that you should ask questions about symptoms which the patient has not described. And in the history, when you present to the examiner, you must also definitely tell about the negative points in the story. That will definitely help you to create a good impression on the examiner. Finally, if there are few points which are not clear to you, then you should ask a leading question. When you ask a leading question, two things are important. One, the question should be framed such that the answer is yes or no. Like, is your pain retrosternal? The answer should be only yes or no. And you must also tell the patient that I am going to ask a question to you for which you should answer yes or no, no description at all. So that the patient can comprehend the question and he can say yes or no. So a leading question is required only when some points are not very clear and you want to clarify certain specific points. You must always ask about the details of treatment and response to treatment. Many patients might have undergone interventional procedures, might have undergone a surgical procedure. Following after the surgical procedure, the patient may, or after the intervention, patient might have been perfectly fine. And now recently has started developing symptoms. So the treatment and the response to treatment should be clearly asked for and documented. The medicines the patient is taking and also the response to the medication also should be always taken note of. Always ask past relevant past history like rheumatic fever, previous history of coronary artery disease, myocardial infarction, all those the history of diabetes, systemic hypertension. So those important points should be always asked. And also always ask family history, especially in conditions like hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Family history is extremely important. Patients' parents may be having hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and then it is easy for you to think about the diagnosis in the present patient also. Comorbidities must always be asked for, and habits. I need not elaborate on that. After you have taken the story, you should have a systematic method to analyze the symptoms. The first question you must always ask, which is, of course, which is irrelevant in cardiology, which system is affected? We know it is almost always, it is a cardiac case that you are going to tackle. But in your regular practice, sometimes you may see a patient who is having a respiratory symptom, which may be mistaken for a cardiac symptom. So it's extremely important that you should analyze which system is affected. Then, if it is serious, which side is affected? Is it a left-sided disease, right-sided disease, or a both-sided disease? What is the nature of the lesion? What is the mechanism which has resulted in the disease process? Are there any complications? How severe is the problem, and what may be the etiology? So you have to go through these six steps, questions that you can yourself ask, and you can quickly draw the conclusions. Let us look at that. Which system is affected? The system affection is decided by the symptoms which are referable to that system. And the cardiovascular symptoms are breathlessness, palpitation, cardiac pain, fatigue, syncope. Syncope can occur at rest as well as on exertion, hemoptysis, edema of dependent parts, right hypochondrial pain, pulsations in the neck, abdominal distension, non-specific symptoms like loss of appetite, gaseous distension of the abdomen, etc. These last symptoms are mostly occurring in patients who have purely a right-sided problem. Patients with constrictive pericarditis, or patients with right-sided endomyocardial fibrosis, or patients with tricuspid valve disease, sometimes can have significant right-sided symptoms. Sometimes they have found patients with constrictive pericarditis, they first go to the gastroenterology department. There the examining doctor might have found elevated JVP, and the patient will be referred to the cardiology department. So sometimes the patient's symptoms can be quite non-specific, especially when there is a right-sided lesion. Of the symptoms, when you ask for the symptoms of breathlessness, never forget to ask for the history of paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. It's extremely important. Palpitation, always ask how is the onset, how is the offset. Is it a regular palpitation or is it an irregular palpitation? Is it a fast palpitation or is it a slow palpitation? All these questions should be asked. In other things, I am not going into the details. Syncope. Well, in breathlessness, I want to highlight one point. In breathlessness, I want to highlight one point. So sometimes the breathlessness due to a respiratory illness may get confused whether it is cardiac or not. One important point that you can always consider is breathlessness not associated with cough is almost always cardiac. Whenever there is a respiratory cause for breathlessness, cough is an important symptom. Very often, cough precipitates breathlessness. So it's extremely important to ask for the history of cough when the patient is becoming breathless. Again, syncope. Sometimes you may have a difficulty in differentiating from loss of consciousness due to a neurological cause. if the patient is having a warning and he says that he had a feeling that he is about to back out, hence he took some precautions, that is most likely a cardiac syndrome. A loss of consciousness due to neurological causes very often happens like a blow from the bolt, and patient does not have any time to take a precaution because he does not get any warning. Hemoptysis is not a very common symptom in cardiology, but it can occur in patients with mitral stenosis, in patients with pulmonary arterial hypertension, patients with cyanotic congenital heart disease. So hemoptysis can be a symptom of cardiovascular system disease, but hemoptysis more frequently occurs in respiratory illnesses. So if it is a cardiovascular system disease, next you have to ask a question, which side is affected? Is it a left-sided disease, right-sided disease, or a both-sided disease? If there is a history of paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, you are 100% certain that it is a left-sided disease. But if the patient is having breathlessness as a symptom, most commonly it is a left-sided disease. Rarely, in patients with pure right-sided disease, symptom of breathlessness can occur. For example, the most common symptom with which patients with primary pulmonary arterial hypertension present is as exertional breathlessness. The pattern very often followed is a patient may start with a left-sided disease. He may get episodes of paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. Then it progresses to right-sided disease, and the paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea may even come down, and he may have symptoms and signs suggestive of right-sided disease. Then you can consider that the patient is having a both-sided disease. If the patient is having purely edema, abdominal symptoms, and also he says that he has facial puffiness, then you should start thinking that it is mostly a right-sided disease. So the next question that we ask ourselves is it a left-sided disease or a right-sided disease or a both-sided disease? What is the nature of the lesion? What is the mechanism of disease? Anyone of the participants, would you like to answer this question? What do you mean by mechanism of disease? Ashok, would you like to try that? Can you motivate yourself and try to answer? What is the mechanisms of disease in cardiovascular system? Any one of you? Rajesh? Okay, if there are none, anyway, I'll go to that.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
First of all, we should know exact cause of that symptom, that is myocardial disease or valvular heart disease or pericardial disease. We should first divide this on the basis of symptom and guess which mechanism involved in this disease.
Very good. What is your name?
Mohammad Ejaz Alam.
Mohammad Ejaz Alam. Where are you from?
Patna Medical College, sir.
Yeah, very good. So I will make it a little more elaborate. You should think of hemodynamically. So what is it? So what is the nature of the lesion? The nature of the lesion can be hemodynamically thinking and volume overload. Heart is getting more and more volume overloaded. Heart becomes bigger and bigger, and gradually over a period of time it may fail. The volume overload lesions are regurgitant lesions and shunt lesions. The most important symptom of volume overload is palpitation. Palpitation precedes all other symptoms for sometimes even for a number of years. Mitral regurgitation, aortic regurgitation, ventricular septal defect, atrial nectus arteriosus, atrial septal defect, all our rolling overload conditions. You will be able to detect cardiomegaly. Patient may have palpitation as a symptom, but their exercise tolerance may be very good. A patient with aortic regurgitation, even moderate to severe, sometimes can have palpitation as a very important symptom, but on treadmill, they may even complete stage 4 of the Bruce protocol. That is because the hemodynamic changes of exercise actually improves, or rather favors, the improvement of aortic regurgitation. Like, one, the heart rate increases, so the aortic regurgitation becomes less. Two, peripheral vasodilatation, so there is more forward flow and less of regurgitation. And with exercise, the improvement in ionotropicity results in increase in the force of contraction. So these patients can improve. So palpitation, an important symptom of rolling overload. Next, important hemodynamic abnormality, which can result in cardiac dysfunction, is pressure overload. These are the conditions in which heart is made to pump against high pressure. Aortic stenosis, systemic hypertension, pulmonary arterial hypertension, pulmonary stenosis, hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, all come under this category. Exertional syncope is the most important symptom, which will make you suspect that it is a pressure overload condition. Third mechanism which can result in a cardiac malfunction is myocardial disease. Example, coronary artery disease is the most important reason for myocardial dysfunction. Dilated cardiomyopathy. These patients will have low output symptoms. They feel tired, lethargic, and they steadily their effort tolerance comes down. They can have symptoms of pulmonary congestion like breathlessness, and depending upon the left ventricular involvement, they can have even symptom of paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. Some of these patients can have both right and left ventricular involvement. In that case, they may present with symptoms of both right and the left side disease. Constrictive or restrictive physiology. Constrictive or restrictive physiology. Example, constrictive pericarditis, restrictive cardiomyopathy, endomyocardial fibrosis, amyloidosis. They may present with restrictive physiology or constrictive physiology in constrictive pericarditis. Most of these patients will have right heart failure as the most important symptom. They can have abdominal distension, and many times symptoms referable to gastrointestinal tract. Arrhythmias itself sometimes can give rise to cardiac symptoms, include palpitation. These include atrial fibrillation, ectopic beats, complete heart block, Morbid type 2 block, Six-hand syndrome, ventricular tachycardia or ventricular fibrillation in certain disease states like QT prolongation syndrome, in patients with coronary artery disease, SCAR VT. So there are a number of situations where arrhythmias can be the one which is precipitating problems. The patients may complain of palpitation during arrhythmia. In complete heart block or six-hand syndrome, patients can have syncope, or some of the patients can, who are going for ventricular fibrillation, can have sudden cardiac death also. So arrhythmia is another hemodynamic abnormality which can precipitate symptoms in patients with heart disease. Patients who are presenting with acute symptoms, you must consider two conditions. One, acute pulmonary edema. It can occur in patients with ischemia, ischemia-induced left ventricular failure. Acute rise in blood pressure can precipitate acute left ventricular failure. Patients with a prosthetic valve, when they develop valve thrombosis, they can present, especially mitral valve. Mitral valve prosthetics, prosthetic mitral valve. Some of the patients may slip may stop their anticoagulation and may come with acute breathlessness. It is due to the thrombus formation in a prostatic valve resulting in acute pulmonary edema. Patients with mitral stenosis, when they develop atrial fibrillation, may develop acute breathlessness. Acute aortic regurgitation, mitral regurgitation in the setting of infective endocarditis or acute pulmonary embolism. All these are situations where patients may present with acute symptoms. So the onset of symptoms is extremely important to interrogate. And based on that, you can find out what is the situation which precipitated acute symptoms. Increase in demand due to extra cardiac causes may be the cause for heart failure. These patients will have high output heart failure. For example, thyrotoxicosis, beriberi, anemia. These are situations where patients may even present with heart failure, where the heart may be working more. High output heart failure. If you touch these patients' fingers, you will find their fingers are warm. While patients with low output heart failure, their extremities will be cold. So if you find a patient in significant heart failure, or something happened to my screen sharing. Hello? If somebody wants to ask a question? Okay, so the increase in demand due to extra cardiac cause, like thyrotoxicosis, beriberi, anemia, also can present with heart failure. So never forget that extra cardiac cause also must be in your mind when a patient is coming with heart failure. Now, the fourth question that you have to ask, are there any complications? Can anyone of you tell me how you can recognize from the story whether the patient had a complication or not? Any one of you? Ashok, would you like to try? Pass me. Arvind? Anybody? Dr. Bhattacharya? I always encourage the students to answer, discuss, and that is the best way to learn. Yes? I think one of the doctors is coming. Anybody who is, hello, yes, again, you are audible to me. Very good.
Hello, sir.
Oh, okay, very good, yes.
Yeah, if a patient comes with a chest pain,
okay,
and the ECG is showing ST elevation MI,
okay,
and while auscultating the patient, we hear a pansystolic murmur in the apex.
No, I am telling you, the patient has come to you and he's giving you a story only. He has not been hospitalized, no ECG, nothing.
No, okay, he comes to our OPD and we are clinically assessing him. We are auscultating the patient.
No, don't auscultate. From the history, how will you...
Sir, like patient complains of some exertion or weight lifting, and after that he complains of sudden onset of chest pain, breathlessness, then we can suspect a rupture sinus of Valsalva, like that.
Okay, when he has done an unusual activity which has resulted in a symptom protection. But more important is that I will tell you how to recognize a complication. A sudden deterioration in the course of the illness points towards a complication. For example, a patient was detected to have a heart lesion about 10 years ago. Let us say aortic stenosis, or let us say systemic hypertension. patient was perfectly fine. About 6 months ago, he suddenly started deteriorating. He started developing symptoms and his effort tolerance has come down. You must always suspect that patient has developed a complication at that stage. Complication can be a cardiac complication or an extracardiac complication. The most important cardiac complication, which can suddenly cause a deterioration of the cardiac status, is development of atrial fibrillation, which can happen in patients with systemic hypertension, patients with mitral valve disease, mitral regurgitation, patients with left ventricular dysfunction. There are a huge number of conditions where patients can develop atrial fibrillation. So if the patient says that he suddenly deteriorated, you should suspect that patient might have developed a complication. The most important complication that you should suspect is atrial fibrillation. There can be other complications like patients who might have had fever for some time, maybe for a month, or might have taken treatment for prolonged fever. He may suddenly deteriorate. Infective endocarditis may go in for acute valvular regurgitation. So that is another reason for deterioration. Sometimes a rupture of a cortex, pulmonary embolism, especially in a patient who is bedridden, or a patient who was undergone a hip surgery, development of ischemia or recurrence of ischemia, rheumatic reactivation, or patient who has mitral regurgitation may develop systemic hypertension. What is the problem of systemic hypertension in a patient with mitral regurgitation? Anyone of you, hemodynamically, what is the problem if the patient develops systemic hypertension? What will happen to mitral regurgitation?
Sir, can I come in, sir?
Yes, please.
If there is systemic hypertension, there will be increased LV end diastolic pressure, which in turn increases the volume of mitral regurgitation.
End diastolic pressure will increase the volume of mitral regurgitation. What do you mean by that?
So LV to LA pressure gradient will increase.
Mitral regurgitation
will increase.
Oh, that's right. But can you repeat the answer?
The systemic hypertension will cause increase in the LV end diastolic pressure.
No, that's not right. The systemic hypertension will increase LV systolic pressure. End diastolic pressure can rise, but end diastolic pressure rise will not increase mitral regurgitation. Mitral regurgitation is a systolic event. So if the patient is what is that thing which drives the mitral regurgitation? The systolic pressure in the LV against the systolic pressure in the LA. If the patient is having systemic hypertension, let us say 160 or 180 systolic pressure and diastolic pressure 100. The patient's gradient, the LV systolic pressure is 180 and LV left atrial pressure may be, let us say, 10 or 11. So the pressure head which drives mitral regurgitation significantly increases, resulting in an increase in mitral regurgitation. Is it clear to you?
Sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
It is the systolic pressure which decides the mitral regurgitation.
Okay.
I agree with you that left ventricular end diastolic pressure can go up in patients with severe systemic hypertension. But that will not contribute to development of mitral regurgitation. You must always look for extracardiac causes also, like anemia, infection, development of thyrotoxicosis. These patients can also deteriorate. So the complications can be cardiac complications or extracardiac complications. Of the cardiac complications, most important is atrial fibrillation. When these patients develop atrial fibrillation, which is the most common stable cardiac arrhythmia, patients can deteriorate. Why do patients deteriorate when they develop atrial fibrillation? Anyone of you? Why do patients deteriorate when they develop atrial fibrillation?
Sir, the aortic atrial kick is lost. So the contribution to the stroke volume, that atria contributes about 15 to 30% to the stroke volume.
Oh, even if the patient is, for example, in patients with systemic hypertension, sometimes the atria may be contributing to maybe even up to 40% of the left ventricular filling. But when they develop atrial fibrillation, will the ventricular filling come down by 40%? Hello?
No, sir.
How much will it work? Why? What is the compensatory mechanism? When the atrium is not contracting, what will happen to the blood volume in the atrium?
Increases,
very good. When the blood volume increases, what will happen to the pressure?
Increases.
Yeah, there is a mean increase in the atrial pressure. Mean increase in the atrial pressure. That is what is happening. That will partly compensate the reduction in filling due to the lack of atrial key. Because the mean left atrial pressure goes up, that will result in some degree of ventricular filling being maintained. There may be some reduction in the ventricular filling because of the atrial kick is taken away. But the increase in the mean left atrial pressure will result in some degree of compensation to the ventricular filling. But what is it is at the expense of what? When the mean left atrial pressure goes up, what happens? What happens to the pulmonary venous pressure?
Increases.
When it increases, the patient can go in for symptoms of pulmonary congestion. One. Two, atrial fibrillation many times can result in a faster ventricular rate. That can also, if the patient is already having a malfunctioning ventricle, the patient's condition can quickly deteriorate. In patients with mitral stenosis, when the heart rate goes up, what will happen? Any one of you? In a patient with mitral stenosis, when they develop atrial fibrillation, what are the hemodynamic abnormalities? Anyone of you?
Diastolic gradient will be increased, sir.
Diastolic gradient will be increased. Why the diastolic gradient increases?
Increased ventricular rate will cause less duration for.
Very good. When there is an increase in the heart rate, that will result in the diastolic pace comes down, resulting in the ventricular filling time comes down, resulting in larger volume of blood in the left atrium. The left atrial pressure goes up, and the patient can get the patient can develop acute pulmonary edema. The patients with mitral stenosis, when they develop atrial fibrillation, they develop acute symptoms. There is also a thought process. And even in patients with mitral stenosis, atrium can contribute to some degree to ventricular filling. This may not be true in severe mitral stenosis, but in moderate and mild mitral stenosis, it is still possible. But the most important reason is increase in the heart rate. So these are the, whenever you think of a complication, always think of atrial fibrillation. And a sudden deterioration in the course of the illness of the patient points towards a complication. And atrial fibrillation always should be in your mind when the patient says that I have suddenly deteriorated. Now let's take the next point. How severe is the problem? Of course, severity is actually decided by the symptoms. Then you have a New York Heart Association classification, class 1 to class 4, and that will give you an idea about the severity of the disease process. Patients who are having class 4 symptoms or class 3 symptoms, they are much more disabled and much more severe disease than patients who are in class 1 or class 2. So the New York Heart Association classification, class 1 to class 4, is something which will help you to decide the severity of the disease process. I'm not asking a question on class 1 to class 4 definition, because I have found that many students do not know what is class 1 to class 4. So I will give the definition. Class 1 is a patient who is having heart disease. New York Heart Association classification refers only to patients with heart disease. So class 1 is a patient who is having a heart disease, who is asymptomatic on normal routine activities. Unaccustomed exercise may or may not precipitate symptoms. And symptoms considered are cardiac pain, breathlessness, palpitation, or fatigue. Anyone is enough. Class 2 is a patient who is having mild symptoms, who is symptomatic on normal routine activities. Class 3 is a patient who is having moderate symptoms, who is comfortable at rest, but less than normal routine activity precipitates symptoms. And class 4 is a patient who is severely symptomatic, who can be symptomatic at rest or cannot perform any duty without developing symptoms. You must understand class 1 to class 4 exactly like this. And when you are a description, you should put the patient in which class of New York Heart Association classification that particular patient belongs. So that is class 1 to class 4. That will give you an idea about the severity of the disease process. Now you must also think what may be the etiology, because ultimately when you give the final cardiac diagnosis, etiology is the first one that you have to mention. There are not many etiological reasons for development of heart disease. They include congenital heart disease, rheumatic heart disease, coronary artery disease, hypertensive heart disease, pericardial disease, myocardial diseases, various myocardial diseases, including myocarditis, degenerative diseases like degenerative calcific aortic stenosis, sometimes idiopathic. The cause is not known. Some of the patients with sick sinus syndrome, we do not know why they develop sick sinus syndrome. So idiopathic. Sometimes the etiology may be just an arrhythmia or a systemic disease affecting the heart. So you must always have an idea what may be the etiology in this particular patient which has resulted in a symptom. Because at the end, when you give the diagnosis, you have to give etiology as one of the points. Now from here, now I have finished the story, how to analyze. And from the story part which I have mentioned, if you, any one of you want any clarification, any doubts to be raised, now you can do it. Okay, now we will go to history in congenital heart disease. Congenital heart disease must be looked at slightly differently from the regular adult cardiac illness. What is the purpose of history in a child suspected to have heart disease? We would like to answer these questions. Is the child having a heart lesion? If it is yes, then what is the nature of the lesion? How severe is the problem? Is it a severe problem or a mild problem? And are there any complications? In the story, we would like to address all these points so that we get a point, we get a correct answer. Before that, whenever you see, is the child having a heart lesion? As soon as you see the child, you must look at A, B, C, D, E. What are these A, B, C, D indicate? A means activity of the child. If the child is very active, a 1-year-old child is very active, he is looking at you, he is catching hold of your stethoscope, he is pulling at your pen, then the child is very active. Now what is the breathing? Is the child breathing normally? If the child is tachypneic, or is having difficulty in breathing, if everything is normal, what is the color? Is the patient bluish? Is having normal color? Has the patient developed to his age? Especially developmental milestones are normal. Child looks intelligent enough, so the development is normal. And is the child having any external evidence of internal disease, like some syndrome? So if A, B, C, D, E are normal, most likely the child is not having any heart lesion, or if at all, it is a mild disease. Always you can have a quick look. Activity, breathing, color, development, and external evidence of internal disease. Then we have to look at, from the story, what are the points which will tell us that the child is having a heart lesion? One is symptoms of heart failure. For example, patient is tachypneic, patient is having head sweats, difficulty in feeding, unexplained crying. The child cries without any reason. Child prefers upright position when the child is kept in the lap of the mother or the grandmother. Child starts crying. But if the child is kept on the shoulders, child immediately quietens down. That may tell you that the child prefers an upright position, and that may be an evidence of heart failure. Cold extremities. Usually children have warm extremities. The cold extremities is another additional point for you to suspect that the patient, the child may be having a heart lesion. Following points in the history also indicate heart disease. Bluish discoloration of the skin and lips, especially more on crying, cyanosis. If the child is running about, walking around, intermittent squatting. Children with cyanotic spells. The child, children who are not growing well, failure to thrive, failure to grow. Recurrent respiratory tract infection, especially lower respiratory tract infection. Detection of a murmur by a pediatrician or immediately after delivery, or increased precordial activity detected by the mother or grandmother. So these are all points which will make you suspect that the child may be having a heart lesion. If the child is having heart lesion, then what is the nature of the lesion? Just like in adult cardiology, we would like to know what is the nature of the lesion. The approach is slightly different, that's all. You must first recognize whether it is a cyanotic problem or a non-cyanotic problem. Detection of murmur at birth. If the pediatrician of the hospital has detected a cardiac murmur, then most likely the child is having either an obstructive lesion or a regurgitant lesion. Shunt lesions do not develop murmurs immediately after birth. Heart failure in the first week of life. You must suspect obstructive lesions, regurgitant lesions, complex lesions, like AV canal defect, admixture lesions without pulmonary stenosis, like single ventricle, AV common atrium, an admixture lesion without or total anomalous pulmonary venous drainage, transposition of great arteries without pulmonary stenosis, arrhythmias. Sometimes patients with supraventricular arrhythmias may present with heart failure, metabolic abnormalities, like hypocalcemia, hypoglycemia, both can precipitate heart failure in babies. So, heart failure in the first week of life. No symptoms for 1 to 2 months and develop symptoms. Consider shunt lesions. For example, large ventricular septal defect, large patent ductus arteriosus. If the symptoms regress over a period of time, then you should suspect a reduction in the size of the defect. For example, a patient with a large ventricular septal defect, if the defect decreases in size or the defect closes, the patient can become less symptomatic. Development of pulmonary arterial hypertension or development of RV outflow obstruction. In a child with shunt lesion, the left to right shunt gradually comes down. The patient becomes less symptomatic. Some of the patients with pulmonary atresia, development of larger and multiple aortic pulmonary collaterals may make the patient less symptomatic. Patient may be deeply cyanosed, but the patient may become slightly less symptomatic because of effective lateral flow. If symptoms regress over a period of time and then gradually deteriorate, suspect Eisenmenger syndrome, or in a patient who is known to have a ventricular septal defect, you should suspect the patient must be developing significant aortic regurgitation. So the regression of symptoms for a period of time, and then gradually the patients deteriorate, start suspecting Eisenmenger syndrome or aortic regurgitation in a patient with ventricular septal defect. So a properly taken story may give you a clue what may be the problem the child is having.
Yes, sir. Tell me.
Yeah. Would like to ask a question? Any questions? Okay. If the child is cyanotic, then deep cyanosis from birth, you must consider admixture lesions with pulmonary stenosis, or transpositional lesions with these are the conditions where there can be cyanosis at birth. Admixture lesions, as you know, are lesions where there is one chamber where both systemic as well as pulmonary venous blood gets mixed up, as can occur in total anomalous pulmonary venous drainage, single ventricle, single atrium, single ventricle, fungus arteriosus, and even in tricuspid atresia, where the blood can get mixed up in one chamber. Transposition physiology, transposition of great arteries. That also is another situation where there can be cyanosis from birth. No cyanosis at birth, cyanotic from first or second week, sometimes even at the end of a month. Consider tetralogy of viral-like situation, VSTPS situation. There are many theories regarding this phenomenon where patients with tetralogy of Fallot may present after 1 or 2 weeks or even after a month with cyanosis. We will discuss those points when we discuss a case of that nature. But in the story, if the history of cyanosis is after a month or so, you must start suspecting something like a VSTPS physiology. How severe is the problem? Is it a major cardiac ailment or is it a minor problem? Symptoms will definitely help you. Following indicate significant heart lesion, which include history of heart failure, developmental delay, recurrent lower respiratory tract infection, cyanosis. Due to any reason, if there is cyanosis, you have to think that there is a major problem. Associated features like rubella syndrome, Down syndrome, and various other syndromes will tell you that the child is having a significant heart lesion. All these things will tell you are dealing with a child with a major problem. Are there any complications? The important complications of congenital heart disease are heart failure, recurrent lower respiratory tract infection, cyanotic spells, especially tetralogy of Fallot-like situation, development of pulmonary arterial hypertension, Eisenmenger syndrome, brain abscess, especially in cyanotic congenital heart disease where there is a right-left shunt. Brain abscess can happen. Hemoptysis sometimes can be massive. Paradoxical embolism. Arrhythmias like complete heart block in L transposition of great arteries. Patients with post-op tetralogy of Fallot can develop various arrhythmias. Atrial arrhythmias can occur in Epstein's anomaly. So these are the few complications that can happen in various congenital heart disease. And history can give you a clue whether the patient is having a complication or not. So, to give some idea, murmur detected on the first day of life, suspect stenotic or regurgitant lesion. You must also make out whether the patient is cyanotic or non-cyanotic. If the child is cyanotic from birth, or is the cyanosis appeared after a period of few weeks. In tetralogy of phyllo-like situations, the cyanosis may be delayed. The cyanosis may be detected from birth in admixture lesions and transposition physiology. You must always make out whether it is a high flow or a low flow disease. High flow means high pulmonary blood flow. Low flow means reduced pulmonary blood flow. If the patient is having symptoms of heart failure or recurrent respiratory tract infection, that usually points to a high flow congenital heart disease. In low flow congenital heart disease, symptoms are usually history of squatting, history of cyanotic spells, and delay in developmental milestones. So if you take a proper story, you can make out whether the patient is having a serious illness, whether the patient is having a high flow situation or a low pulmonary blood flow situation, and also whether the patient is developing a complication. So a proper story will be a stepping stone or a step towards making a correct diagnosis in patients with congenital heart disease. Before we go to the clinical examination, I would like to ask the students whether they have any doubts or any clarifications required or not. Okay, if there are none, then I will continue with my...
Regarding this recurrent respiratory tract infection, is there a criteria like number of these many episodes should be considered as recurrent?
Well, there are multiple criteria. I think you can verify it. But if the patient requires a hospitalization for respiratory tract infection, that can be considered as a major problem.
Even if it is a single episode?
Yeah, one single episode is a very serious situation. Well, you need intravenous antibiotics. Secondly, during the first year, up to 4 to 5 can be taken as normal. So, if it is 6 or more, then you have to take that it is an is a increased respiratory tract infection. Subsequently, respiratory tract infection usually comes down. The first year is the most important period, where these patients with high flow situation present with respiratory tract infection, because that is the period when they can develop heart failure, which predisposes for recurrent respiratory tract infection.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Now we'll go to the physical examination. In the physical examination, of course, in the general physical examination, you should look for cyanosis and clubbing. And the most important is you should recognize central cyanosis from peripheral cyanosis. Extremely easy. You touch the patient in central cyanosis, extremities will be warm. In peripheral cyanosis, extremities will be cold. And of course, the cyanosis of the mucous membranes, lips, the tongue, the mouth, all indicate it is a central cyanosis. The central cyanosis can be few types. One, what is meant by differential cyanosis? Anyone of you? This is a simple question. Differential cyanosis.
Yes.
What do you mean by differential cyanosis?
Hello, sir.
Yes.
A differential cyanosis means when the upper limbs are not cyanosed, but the lower limbs are cyanosed.
Very good. Condition?
Transposition of great arteries.
Transposition of great arteries. Differential cyanosis.
PDA with Eisenmenger syndrome.
Yes. endocarditis arteriosus with Eisenmenger syndrome? Can you get cyanosis of the both lower limbs and right upper limb and left upper limb is spared?
I don't know.
If the right subclavian is aberrant origin, we can use.
Beg your pardon?
Sir, if the right subclavian is originating from the distal part of the aorta.
Very good. Aberrant right subclavian. So if there is a 0.2% of people can have aberrant right subclavian, and when there is an aberrant subclavian or right subclavian which is arising beyond the region where the ductus joins, so in a patient with patent ductus arteriosus, Eisenmenger syndrome, both lower limbs may be cyanosed and upper limb will be spared. Left upper limb will be spared and right upper limb also will be cyanosed. Can you get a reverse differential cyanosis?
Yes, sir. In TVA with the PDA with the reversal of the shunt, we can.
Very good. In a patient with transposition of great arteries, with PDA with reversal can have reverse.
Or in tossing being anomaly along with PDA reversal of shunt.
Very good. Yes, sir. So these are the situations where you can have differential cyanosis. So now coming to pulse, I'm not touching upon pulse, but JVP is a very important point because many students fail in JVP. The examiner sits on JVP and you are stuck there. I would like to clarify a few points in the JVP description. One, you have to describe the wave pattern. Two, you should also make a statement about what is the mean jugular venous pressure elevation. Many students describe about the waves, but they don't make a statement about mean jugular venous pressure elevation. Can any one of you tell me how can you mention about mean jugular venous pressure elevation? Many times you look at the waves, and then how will you say what is the mean jugular venous pressure elevation? Any one of you?
Hello, sir.
How will you say what is the mean jugular venous pressure elevation?
Sir, with the help of scale, we have to measure from the point sternal. Hello, sir.
No, that's you are measuring the column of the top of the column. How will you say what would be the mean jugular venous pressure?
Sir, if it is more than 9 centimeter of water, we will say it is increased mean jugular venous pressure.
That's it. I agree with you that the jugular venous pressure is elevated if it is more than 6 centimeters above the angle of Louis. But how will you say you can look at the A waves, you can look at the B waves, you can look at X wave, X descent, Y descent. What will be how will you say the mean jugular venous pressure?
Sorry, sir. Wrong.
Any one of you? The mean jugular venous pressure is usually 3 to 4 centimeters less than the top of the A and the B waves. So once you find the A and the B waves, and if you reduce by about 3 to 4 centimeters, then that will be the mean jugular venous pressure. For example, in the normal atrium, what is the maximum A or B wave? What is the maximum accepted height of the A or the B wave in the right atrium?
A wave is 6, B wave is 5, sir.
That's a normal. Upper limit is up to 8. You can normally 6 and 5. A is slightly taller than the B wave, but sometimes up to 8 is taken as upper limit of normal. And the normal mean right atrial pressure is around 3 to 5, which is usually about 3 to 4 centimeters less than the top level of the A or the B wave. So you can look at that. Then how to recognize the waves? No problems. A wave, you all of you know, precedes the carotid pulse. Sharp rise, sharp fall. B wave follows the carotid pulse. Slow rise, rapid fall. Can you tell me one condition where B wave will not have a rapid fall? Any one of you?
Tricuspid stenosis.
Very good. In patients with tricuspid stenosis, there won't be any rapid fall. X descent, It is the most prominent wave in a normal dura venous pressure pattern. It occurs after the A wave. How will you make out whether it is X descent or Y descent? Anyone of you? When you are seeing a descent, how will you make out whether it is very often it is difficult because you are seeing multiple waves? How will you make out whether it is an X descent or a Y descent? Anyone of you?
If it along with the apical impulse, it is X descent, sir.
Beg your pardon?
Along with the apical impulse, it is coming, it is X descent, sir.
Oh, well, to some extent, you are right. Okay, yes.
Sir, actually, we can keep it with the first heart sound. It coincides with the first heart sound.
It is just before the first heart sound. Because, see, what is the thing which coincides with the first heart sound is the C wave.
Okay. C waves are usually not seen, sir.
But if you look at the timing, the atrium has started relaxing and excess already started occurring before S1.
Okay, sir.
But if you look at auscultate and look for S2, because S2 is the one which you can easily listen. And the one which occurs after the S2 is white set.
Okay.
It's very easy to recognize. And in a patient with slow heart rate, the interval between Y to X is longer. Because it occurs in diastole. Y to X is longer, while X to Y is shorter. But if the heart rate is faster, then this cannot apply. In a slower heart rate, later on 60 or 65, the Y to X interval will be much longer. But easiest is you auscultate, and if you are hearing a second heart sound very here, you can auscultate pulmonary area for the second heart sound. And the one which occurs immediately after the second heart sound is the Y descent. And you can also look at the longer interval. Y to X descent is a longer interval than X to Y. That's difficult actually. But the easiest is to recognize the Y descent. Can you tell me one condition where X descent is prominent? One condition where Y descent is prominent? And why one condition where Y descent can even disappear?
Y descent prominent in consecutive pericarditis.
Very good. It goes by the, what is the name? What is the name?
Israel, sir.
Huh?
Israel.
What is the name? What is the sign?
It's like
Beirut sound sign. Frederick sign.
Frederick sign. Okay, very good. Yes. We will discuss in detail when we get the case of constrictive pericarditis, but I'm asking you why descent is prominent in constrictive pericarditis. Why descent absent in?
Cardiac tamponade, sir.
Very good. Why descent is absent in cardiac tamponade? And X descent is prominent in?
Cardiac tamponade, sir.
Cardiac tamponade. Very good. What is your name?
Israel, sir.
Oh, you are the same person. Okay, right. Okay, very good. So, X descent is prominent in cardiac tamponade. Y descent is prominent in constrictive pericarditis, and Y descent is absent in cardiac tamponade. Now, sometimes there can be a problem of blood pressure recording, not commonly, but a patient with severe aortic regurgitation having pistol shot sound. How will you record the diastolic blood pressure? You are hearing the sound even when it is zero. So how will you record it? Beg your pardon?
Muffling or the fourth heart sound.
Yes, muffling of the sound. You should record muffling of the sound as the diastolic blood pressure. The general principle is that whenever you are recording the blood pressure, when you are recording blood pressure of a patient with a low peripheral resistance, the muffling of the sound better corresponds with the diastolic blood pressure. In a person with increased peripheral resistance, the disappearance of the sound corresponds better with the diastolic blood pressure. That is why sometimes when you record the blood pressure in small babies, you record the diastolic blood pressure when the sound actually muffles. So the diastolic blood pressure in a low peripheral resistance situation is when the sound muffles, and in an increased spatial resistance situation, as in normal adults, when the sound disappears. If you want to clarify further, you can write down, let us say you are recording the blood pressure of a patient with severe aortic regurgitation. You can record as 140 bar 30 bar 0, not bar, dash 0. It means the sound appeared at 140 systolic blood pressure, at muffled at 30 diastolic blood pressure, but the sound was audible even at 0. Can the aortic diastolic pressure be 0? Anyone of you? Can the aortic diastolic blood pressure be 0?
Not below 40.
No, sir, it can't be 0, sir.
Why?
Coronary perfusion pressure, it won't, to get proper coronary blood flow, diastolic blood pressure should be higher than end-diastolic blood pressure.
No, you should answer hemodynamically. This is not a hemodynamic answer. It is the effect of lower pressure. I am asking you an answer which is hemodynamic. When the aortic pressure is zero, what will happen to the aortic valve? If the aortic pressure becomes 0 and the LV diastolic pressure is 10, what will happen to the aortic valve?
Opens.
So when the LV diastolic pressure exceeds the aortic pressure, the aortic valve has to open. So you cannot have a 0 aortic pressure, because at that time the blood can flow from LV to the aorta. So 0 aortic pressure is not possible. Okay, that is a hemodynamic question. Now we'll look at the, let me see whether I can show you. An example of a patient with jugular venous pressure. I will run it. Where do you look for jugular venous pressure code? This is the neck of the patient. You are seeing very prominent pulsations here.
I cannot see.
Can you see the prominent pulsations here?
The
video is not shared.
Okay, let me see. Let me share it.
Need to share the video.
You share. Okay. Or you can stop share. No, I'll share it. Can you see now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you are seeing pulsations here. Is it the area where you look for the pulsations? This is the back of the patient. This is the front of the patient.
Between two heads of sclerotomastoid.
Very good.
Prominent ones are the carotids.
No, they are not carotids. There must be anterior jugular or maybe an aberrant external jugular. This is not carotid, this is jugular venous pulsation. You can look at it here. See, you cannot get this type of a collapse in a carotid pulsation. So you should look at between the two heads of sternocleidomastoid muscle. Sometimes it may be seen behind the clavicular head of sternocleidomastoid muscle. This is the region you should look for. You can clearly see the pulsations here. And as you go to the middle of the neck, the jugular vein is posterior or deep to the sternocleidomastoid muscle, and as you go to the upper one third of the neck, it is partly underneath and partly in front of the jugular venous pressure and in front of the sternocleidomastoid muscle. I will repeat, the internal jugular vein is between the two heads of the sternocleidomastoid muscle, or sometimes even partly posterior to the clavicular head of the sternocleidomastoid muscle in lower one third. In the middle one third, it is deep to the sternocleidomastoid muscle, and in upper one third, it is partly deep and partly in front of the sternocleidomastoid muscle. So that is the region where you have to look for the internal jugular venous pulsation. Here you can beautifully see internal jugular venous pulsations, and it's up to the middle of the neck. You can see the pulsations up to here. once you have evaluated that jugular venous pressure column is elevated, you are seeing the internal jugular vein is pulsating, and suppose you think that the another superficial vein like anterior jugular vein or external jugular vein gives you a much better idea about the wave pattern, you can always look at that. But initially, you should always look at the internal jugular vein to make it certain that it is elevated and the level of jugular vein pressure column. For the study of the wave pattern, sometimes a superficial vein may give you a better clue. So this is a patient with a tricuspid regurgitation, and you can see very prominent wide descent. Patient has very prominent wide descent. So you can have a significant CV wave that is followed by a significant wide descent, which is very clear in the anterior jugular vein compared to an internal jugular vein. But you have to look at the internal jugular vein to make it certain that the jugular vein pressure column is definitely elevated. Okay, well, any doubts about JVP? You should be very clear how to describe the waves A, V, X, and Y for DM students. What is the mean jugular vein pressure column? And of course, I'm not going into the method of examining the jugular vein pressure column that we will discuss in one of our case discussions. So these are the descriptions that you should give in examination. You should always give a description of the mean jugular vein pressure column. If your description is complete, there will not be any more questions from the examiner, so that you are clean to go to the next level, that is the pre-caudal examination. Mm-hmm. Any doubts, any clarifications?
Mean JVP, can you explain again, sir?
So you see, mean jugular vein, so you look at the top level of the A and the B wave and try to reduce 3 to 4 centimeters from that level. That will be the mean jugular vein pressure.
But if it is canon A wave, then also same, sir.
Bigger part in canon waves.
Sir, in canon A waves also, if we reduce...
Okay, so when there are canon A waves, you cannot apply this principle, because canon A, what is canon A wave? You cannot use the word canon A wave. It is a canon wave. There is nothing like canon A wave. You can use the word prominent A wave. There's a difference between canon wave and a prominent A wave. What is the difference?
Canon systolic, A wave diastolic.
Yes, very good. Mm. It is due to the atrial contraction in the late diastole. It's an A wave, and it can become prominent in certain conditions. While canon wave is an A wave occurring or an atrial contraction or a closed atrial ventricular wave during systole. In a canon wave, which phase of the systole the canon wave will be more? You might have found that in the same patient, canon wave is of different heights. In which phase of the cardiac systole, the canon wave will be taller? Early systole or late systole? Anyone of you?
Early systole, late systole, sir.
You said early systole. Who said late systole?
I told late systole, sir.
You said late systole. What is the reason? You have to give the explanation. For everything, there should be a hemodynamic explanation.
Sir, tricuspid valve will be more into the ventricle during the early systole, sir.
Hmm.
After some time, it will start the tricuspid valve maybe into after the once the ventricle start pushing the blood, the tricuspid valve will be into the atria, sir. So that time our
no. In the early phase, it is bulging into the atrium, then it descends into the ventricle.
Yes, sir.
You said it is during early phase.
Yes, sir. Sorry.
Early systole. Any other thoughts? Any other thoughts? In which phase? Is it in the early systole or late systole? The canon waves will be more prominent. What is the right atrial pressure in early systole and late systole? Which is more?
So late systole it is more.
Late systolic is more. Your V wave, so the atrium is filling. So atrium is larger. So when the atrium is larger, what will be the force of contraction?
It will be more.
More. And it is occurring on the top of a V wave. So what will be the height? It is occurring on top of a V wave. So what will be the height of the cannon wave? Will it be more or less?
More, sir.
More. So a cannon wave occurring in the late systole will be much taller, much more prominent than occurring in the early systole. So we'll go, since the question came as prominent A wave, what do you mean by prominent A wave? What is the normal height of the A wave? Normal. Up to now, what is the top normal level?
6 to 8 mm of Hg.
Yeah. 6 to 8 mm of?
Hg.
Hg. So can you convert it into blood column? Centimeters of blood column?
11, sir.
Eh?
11.
No, you, how do you calculate it?
Multiplied by 1.35, sir.
Oh, okay, 1.36 or 1.3, okay. Well, so you multiply with 1.36 and you will get the, so it is upper limit of the A wave, it can be up to, let's say, 10 centimeters. Okay, so what do you mean by prominent A wave and what do you mean by giant A wave? Some people even call it as giant A wave.
Height of the A wave is increased.
Yeah. When the height of the A wave is more than 10 centimeters, that means it is seen well into the neck. Up to 15 centimeters is considered as prominent A wave. And when it is more than 15 centimeters, some people even call it as a giant A wave. But I would feel that it is enough to say it's a prominent A wave. So it's a jerk, it's a very prominent wave, it falls immediately, and it's more than 10 centimeters in height. And usually it occurs in, what are the conditions in which you get prominent A wave? Few conditions. Any one of you, prominent A wave. Beg your pardon?
Tricuspid stenosis, sir.
Very good.
In case of ventricular hypertrophy and pulmonary arterial hypertension.
Okay. Conditions associated with pulmonary arterial hypertension. Okay. Anything else?
Aortic stenosis and LVH also.
Rarely, but not commonly. If there is a Burnham effect, sometimes you can have, but not usually. Another condition is right atrial myxoma. Anyway, I'm coming to that later. I think we need not. So there are many conditions which can give rise to prominent A wave.
Sir, normally also in RA, the A wave is more than V wave, as we say.
Yes, yes.
So normally when we describe the JVP, we say it as A wave is prominently seen, or how we say, sir, for normal?
No, it's very difficult for you to say which wave is prominent by looking at JVP, unless you are absolutely an expert in looking at J11 pressure, because after all the difference is only half to 1 millimeter. If you are distinctly seeing a prominent A wave, yes. Otherwise, it is better to say A and B waves both are seen, seems to be equal. Or most of the times in a patient with the right heart failure, V wave will be more prominent because of what? Usually, V wave is TR, tricuspid regurgitation. Most of these patients who develop pulmonary arterial hypertension secondary to left ventricular disease or left sided disease will develop tricuspid regurgitation. So, most of the times you will see more prominent V wave. A wave prominence is less frequent. There are a few conditions where you can get prominent A wave, we'll come to that. There are conditions where B wave can be prominent. We will discuss that also later. Now we'll proceed to the next slide. Are you able to see the slide?
No, sir.
No, sir.
No. Okay, I have to share again. Are you able to see the slide now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, right. Now, pre-codal examination. From the examination of girls, we'll have sometimes inspection and palpation. Not palpitation, it is palpation. No, palpation, the inspection and palpation can be combined. We need not do a separate inspection and separate palpation. When you palpate, you look at the apex beat, location of the apex beat, the nature of the apical impulse, any palpable events at the apex, like palpable sounds, any thrill, and you must also make out which ventricle is affected. Is it a left-sided ventricle problem, or right-sided problem, or both ventricles are affected? How will you make out by palpating the precordium, whether it is a left-sided left ventricular involvement, right ventricular involvement, or a both ventricular involvement? Anyone of you?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, in right ventricular hypertrophy, we will get the apex will be shifted laterally, sir.
May not and be. Sometimes it can be shifted downwards also, but I agree with you that mostly it is lateral, but it can be shifted down also.
Yes, sir. Epigastric pulsations will be prominent, sir.
Okay, very good.
In LVH or LV hypertrophy, we may get a down and out apex, sir. If it is a LV type of apex, we will get down and out apex, sir.
Okay.
Associated, if pulmonary arterial hypertension features are there, more suggestive of RVH findings, sir.
No, but how will you make out whether it is biventricular? You said left ventricle if it is down and out, but down and out is not enough, all right. It can be down and out, but I agree with you that more often it can be lateral.
Yes, sir.
How will you make out whether it is biventricular?
Parasternal heave.
We
should look for parasternal heave.
Okay.
If that is prominent, then right ventricle is also involved.
Okay. You can have the method to make out by looking at the apical impulse is that you palpate the apical impulse. If it is a localized apical impulse, it is almost always LV. If in patients with warning overload, sometimes a larger area of the apical region may be involved, you can get a forceful apex beat. Then you try to palpate medially. As you palpate medially, if the impulse dies out and there is no parasternal lift, then obviously it is a left ventricular problem. While if the impulse at the apex is diffuse, and as you track medially towards the parasternal region, the impulse continues, and at parasternal region, you are getting a very prominent pulsation, which is continuous with the apical impulse, then you can think that the apex is formed by the right ventricle. Then when to diagnose biventricular involvement? You are getting an apex beat, which is reasonably localized, or maybe even diffuse. But as you track medially, the impulse comes down and almost disappears. And when you reach the parasternal region, you again get the parasternal lift. So there are two impulses. They are separated by a small area where there is very feeble impulse or no impulse, which indicate that the patient is having both left as well as right ventricular involvement. So by looking at the apex beat carefully, apical impulse and the parasternal impulse carefully, you can make out whether it is a left-sided disease only or left ventricle is the one which is involved, or is it a right-sided problem where the apex is found by the right ventricle, and three, whether it is both right as well as left ventricle involved. You should always try this, and after a few trials, you will be able to make out without any difficulty. So when you are doing the palpation, you must always make out whether it is a left-sided disease, left ventricle involvement, it is a right-sided disease, right ventricle forming the apex, or both right and left ventricle are involved in the process. Next important point, cardiomegaly with heaving apex beat. Heaving apex usually indicate severe LV dysfunction, unless the patient has lesions to explain both. So here are two things. One is cardiac enlargement and also heaving apex beat. If there are no lesions to explain both, then you should suspect severe LV dysfunction. For example, I'll tell you an example. A patient with mitral regurgitation is having a heaving apex beat. That usually indicates that the patient is having severe LV dysfunction. But at the same time, patient is having mitral regurgitation, but is having significant systemic hypertension, then he's having heaving apex beat can be explained by the systemic hypertension. There, it does not have any relevance. But if there is a patient who has got a cardiomegaly and is having a heaving apex beat, heaving apex, which can't be explained by the hemodynamics of the lesions the patient is having, then you should suspect that the patient is having significant LV dysfunction. Can anyone of you explain what is the reason why patients with cardiomegaly and heaving apex beat, you are diagnosing LV dysfunction? Hemodynamic explanation.
The pre-injection time is increased.
Very good. Excellent. In a patient with severe LV dysfunction, pre-ejection time is increased, and that will result in a sustained apical impulse, which so that's very important point. Whereas a cardiomegaly with heaving apex beat indicates severe LV dysfunction. Parasternal impulse, you should always look for volume and pressure overload or both. How will you make out in the parasternal impulse whether it is a volume overload or a pressure overload? Any one of you or both?
Sustained or ill-sustained?
Yeah. No, sustained is more important. Of course, I agree with you that if it is sustained, it is more like
pressure overload.
Okay. And there is an area of involvement. If the impulse is felt all over the parasternal region, it's felt in the fifth space, fourth space, third space, and then it is more likely to be a volume overload. But if it is localized to fourth or fifth intercostal space near the parasternal region, lower down, it's more likely to be a pressure overload. In volume overload, a larger area is involved. For example, atrial septal defect. While in a patient with pulmonary stenosis, the impulse will be quite faint. In patients with the tetralogy of Fallot, where there is right ventricular hypertrophy, the precordium is almost always quiet. So it is a volume overload, but the same patient of tetralogy of Fallot develops pulmonary regurgitation, it becomes, so you will be able to appreciate parasternal. So it's a volume overload where you will get a larger area of parasternal. The other one is more localized, just like the apical impulse in LV, heaving and hyperdynamic or a forceful apex beat. The larger area indicates volume overload, a smaller area, but more forceful indicates a pressure overload. When you look at the base of the heart, you must always look for palpable impulse, trill or sounds, both in the pulmonary area as well as aortic area. That's very important to look for trill. Very often you have to make the patient sit up, lean forward, and specifically look in the second left and the right intercostal spaces whether there is a trill or any sound is palpable. And you must always look for suprasternal notch and epigastric position. Coming to the percussion, there is nothing interesting about percussion, but you are not going to get too much information from percussion, but it is mandatory that you look at some of the areas like apical region, pulmonary and aortic areas, whether they are null or not, and whether there is any extension of the right border dullness beyond the sternal border. So that is may not give you too much information, but for completion's sake. Auscultation. One important point is, when the first sound is loud, you must always rule out mitral stenosis. If you are getting a loud S1 in your examination, you are not hearing mid-diastolic rumble, you must always turn the patient to the left, ask the patient to even stop breathing, carefully auscultate for mid-diastolic rumble. The commonest cause of a loud S1 is mitral stenosis. Never forget that. Pansystolic mitral valve prolapse also sometimes can give rise to loud S1. What is the mechanism? Anyone of you?
Sir, click will be falsely we may interpret as loud S1, sir.
Very good. The click can be falsely interpreted as the loudest one. How can you differentiate the click, or how can you make out whether, how can you delay the click?
Sir, we can
ask for a Valsalva.
Okay, one is, you can do a Valsalva, similar one. Valsalva is sometimes difficult.
Standing.
Increase the awareness written by leg raising and lying down.
Okay, is similar then? Okay, that is one thing. You can do, can you do a maneuver in which you can slightly raise the venous return and also increase the peripheral resistance?
Squatting, sir.
Squatting, you make the patient squat. That will raise the peripheral resistance and also slightly increase the venous return, and that can delay the non-ejection click, and you may be able to separate it. So sometimes when you get a loud S1, it may be because of the pansystolic mitral valve prolapse. Then of course you have to look at S3, S4, opening snap, non-ejection click, and basic or ejection click. Nothing to speak. I know you may, all of you must know about the basic ejection click. Can one of you explain what is basic ejection click and in what condition you get it? Anyone of you? Basic ejection.
In inspiration, if the click is varying, that is called as phasic ejection click, sir.
Okay.
In case of pulmonary valvular ejection click, we can get this phasic ejection click. During inspiration, it will decrease, sir.
Okay. It may decrease or even disappear. What is the mechanism?
Sir, in case of pulmonary valvular stenosis, the right ventricular diastolic pressures will be higher than the mean pulmonary arterial pressure during inspiration, sir. So there will be early opening of the pulmonary valve.
The pulmonary valve, what do you say? Pulmonary valve opening is related to mean pulmonary artery pressure.
Sir, for opening of pulmonary artery,
when does the pulmonary valve open? When
the RV systolic pressure, if it crosses the mean pulmonary artery pressure.
Wrong. No.
When diastolic pulmonary. Diastolic pulmonary.
Yes. When the pulmonary valve opens, when the LV pressure, it need not be systolic pressure, RV pressure exceeds the diastolic pressure.
Yes.
So what happens in a patient with pulmonary stenosis?
Sir, RV diastolic pressures will be higher, sir.
Why it will be higher?
Sir.
Why RV diastolic pressures are higher, especially RV end diastolic pressure is higher in a patient with pulmonary stenosis, severe pulmonary stenosis? What is the reason?
RVH.
Yes, RVH. The patients will develop right ventricular hypertrophy. That will lead to elevated RV end diastolic pressure, which can exceed the pulmonary artery diastolic pressure, and in these patients the pulmonary valve can open. But why it is related to respiration?
Sir, it will be more during inspiration, sir.
Very good. During inspiration, larger volume of blood is coming to the right side of the heart. Mm. So the RV pressure exceeds the pulmonary artery diastolic pressure in the late phase of diastole, and the pulmonary valve may dome or even open during late premature opening, and hence you cannot get a click. Can you tell me one condition? What is the situation where you can have a non-basic pulmonary click?
Pulmonary artery dilatation, sir. Idiopathic pulmonary artery hypertension, sir.
In all patients with pulmonary arterial hypertension, when there is a click, there is a vascular click, vascular click is not facing. The valvular click is facing. Can you tell me one condition where a vascular click in a, on the, of the pulmonary valve can be facing? Can you tell me one situation where patients can have phasic ejection click due to a valvular cause? Not a valvular cause, due to a vascular cause without pulmonary artery hypertension. People have sometimes described there can be ejection click in idiopathic dilatation of the pulmonary artery, and that can be phasic.
So phasic off aortic click also can be phasic.
No, very rare, but people have described that the aortic sound becomes less loud, but it cannot disappear. I agree with you that people have described that in tetralogy of Fallot, the aortic click can become phasic and become slightly less loud. But I don't accept it because there is no explanation for that. Okay, now let's go to the next one.
Sir, in atrial septal defect, pulmonary valvular ejection click, what will happen, sir?
In atrial septal defect, why should there be pulmonary ejection click?
Yes, sir. Along with pulmonary valvular stenosis, if it is there.
Oh, even there is a pulmonary valvular stenosis. Sometimes, the problem is that in the patient with atrial septal defect, the volume of blood coming to the right ventricle practically remains the same during systole as well as during diastole. Because during inspiration as well as during expiration. Because during inspiration, when larger volume of blood is coming to the right atrium, that will be compensated by a reduced left to right shunt. So the basic nature of the ejection click may not be appreciated in a patient with AST with pulmonary stenosis.
Similar to RV failure also we can say, no sir?
Yeah. Same thing. Where the volume of the RV remains the same. Where unless there is a change in the volume of RV during inspiration, then only there can be an alteration in the intensity of the ejection click. But in a patient with AST, as well as in patients with severe RV failure, this cannot happen, and then you cannot have a phasic ejection. Is it clear to you?
Hello? Yes, sir.
We have got to take another 10 or 15 minutes. Can we have 10 or 15 minutes to finish off the... Do you have time?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, well, how to describe a murmur? It's very extremely important that you should describe the murmurs properly. There should be 8 points must be mentioned in the description of the murmur. What are those 8 points? One, timing of the murmur. In the timing of the murmur, you have to describe 3 points. One, gross timing, whether it is a systolic murmur, diastolic murmur, or a continuous murmur. Fine timing, is it an early murmur, early systolic, mid-systolic, late-systolic, or pan-systolic murmur. In diastolic, you describe early, mid, and late, but pan is not usual. But if you find a pan-diastolic murmur, I have heard pan-diastolic murmurs, you can describe that. You must also describe about the peaking of the murmur. Is it a late peaking systolic murmur or an early peaking systolic murmur? Late peaking systolic murmurs can occur in severe aortic stenosis, while early peaking murmurs can occur in mild lesions or in aortic sclerosis or ejection systolic murmur in patients with aortic regurgitation. So, timing of the murmur. Next is character of the murmur. Don't use too many descriptive terms. You stick to few. Glowing, musical, usually associated with high-pitched murmurs. Rough and harsh murmurs, usually occurs where there is an patient with aortic stenosis, patients of VSD, where the murmur is high-pitched, with low-pitched overtones. That gives the murmur a rough character, harsh character, rough and harsh. Rumbling murmur is a low-pitched murmur. And for ejection systolic murmurs, it is better to describe as crescendo-decrescendo murmur. Murmur increases first, a diamond-shaped murmur. So, character of the murmur, stick to few descriptive terms. Blowing, musical, high-pitched murmurs. Rough and harsh, high-pitched murmurs with low-pitched overtones. Occurs in aortic stenosis, pulmonary stenosis, ventricular septal defect. Rumbling, low-pitched murmurs, mitral stenosis, tricuspid stenosis. Crescendo, decrescendo, ejection, systolic murmurs. When you use the word ejection systolic murmur, you are meaning three things. One, they are mid-systolic murmurs. Two, it is due to ejection of blood from a ventricle to a great vessel. And three, they are crescendo, decrescendo murmurs. So when you use the word ejection systolic murmur, it implies three points. One, it is a mid-systolic murmur. Two, it is because of the ejection of blood from a ventricle to a great vessel. And three, it is a crescendo, decrescendo, or a diamond-shaped murmur. Which of the murmur? You have to describe whether it is a high-pitched murmur, a medium-pitched murmur, or a low-pitched murmur. When you use the word high, medium, low, you know this already, but I'm just repeating it. The high-pitched murmur should go with blowing musical character. Medium-pitched murmurs usually, they are not exactly medium-pitched, they are mostly high-pitched murmurs with low-pitched overtones, usually occurs in goes with harsh and rough murmur. And low-pitched murmurs are rumbling murmurs. Say the maximum intensity. It's extremely important for you to recognize where the murmur is maximum heard. It can be almost certain that the underlying lesion is below the area where the sound is maximum audible. For example, when you hear a pansystolic murmur maximum at the apex, you think of a problem related to mitral valve, mitral regurgitation. When you hear a pansystolic murmur in the parasternal region, you think of either tricuspid regurgitation or you may think of a ventricular septal defect. So those are the lesions. So the maximum intensity of the murmur will be heard over the region where the lesion is. In a patient with aortic stenosis, the murmur may be best audible in the third left intercostal space or a second right intercostal space. In a patient with pulmonary stenosis, it is best audible in the second left intercostal space. So, carefully auscultate where the murmur is maximum audible. The lesion is underlying that area. So, you can think of the differential diagnosis depending upon the area where you heard the murmur loudest. Selective propagation always helps you, especially in mitral murmurs. The mitral stenosis murmur, mitral regurgitation murmur can be propagated to the axilla and to the back. The aortic stenosis murmur can be propagated to the carotids. And pulmonary stenosis murmur can be better audible in the left shoulder than on the right shoulder. That is because the jet from the stenosed pulmonary valve goes directly to the left pulmonary artery. And hence, the pulmonary stenosis murmur will be audible or radiated better to the left shoulder than to the right shoulder. So when you face a difficulty to make out what is the mechanism of a loud murmur in the base of the heart, sometimes an auscultation of the shoulders may sometimes give you a clue. Change with breathing. Obviously, the murmur which increases on inspiration is the right side of the murmur. Obviously, you know. Change with posture and maneuver. There are many ways I'm not going into it. And of course, grading of the murmur, grade 1 to grade 6. The analysis of signs, I'm not going into many signs, but just some of the points which we had discussed during the description of the jugular vein pressure column. Prominent AVA. Of course, there are in a patient with aortic stenosis, you should be able to recognize the slow rising low volume pulse. Slow rising character is much more important than the low volume character. There are a number of conditions where you can get low volume pulse, like patients with severe LV dysfunction, patients with hypovolemia. But slow rising pulse is a character of severe aortic stenosis. The pulse volume can vary. Varying pulse volume is a feature of atrial fibrillation or conditions associated with AV dissociation. So if it is the rhythm is regular and there is a varying pulse volume, then you can suspect that there is AV dissociation. If it is irregular and varying pulse volume, then you can suspect it is atrial fibrillation. Prominent AVAs, like tricuspid stenosis, pulmonary stenosis, pulmonary arterial hypertension, tricuspid atresia. In a patient who is cyanotic and you are finding a prominent AVA, always suspect tricuspid atresia. Sometimes patients with right atrial myxoma can have prominent AVAs. That is because the right atrial myxoma during diastole can sometimes fall onto the tricuspid orifice and partly obstruct it, resulting in sometimes prominent AVAs. Sometimes aneurysm of sinus of Bell's valva can bulge partly into the tricuspid orifice, obstructing it, and sometimes you may get a prominent AVA. Aneurysm of sinus of Bell's valva bulging and partly obstructing the tricuspid valve. So the prominent AVAs means there is some obstruction or difficulty for emptying the right atrial contents into the right ventricle. It can be at the tricuspid valve level or it can be in the ventricle itself where there is a right ventricular hypertrophy, as can occur in patients with pulmonary stenosis or pulmonary arterial hypertension. They can have prominent AVAs in the neck. Prominent VVAs, of course, the most important reason is tricuspid regurgitation. It can occur, you can see prominent VVAs in patients with ASD with mitral regurgitation. That is because the jet of mitral regurgitation can go through the atrial septal defect into the right atrium. RSOV, rupture of sinus of Bell's valve to right atrium, you can have prominent VVAs. LVRA shunt, you can have prominent VVAs. So there are a number of conditions where you can get prominent VVAs. But the most important reason is tricuspid regurgitation. X and Y descent we have already discussed. Prominent X descent can occur in cardiac tamponade and prominent Y descent in constrictive pericarditis. In cardiac tamponade, the Y descent can even disappear. Cannon waves, we have already discussed partly. It can be regular or irregular. Can any one of you tell me five conditions where you can get regular cannon waves? Any one of you? Regular cannon waves.
Sir, junctional rhythm.
Junctional rhythm, very good.
VT with retrograde conduction.
Very good.
Isorhythmic AV dissociation, sir.
Isorhythmic AV dissociation will not give rise to regular tremors.
Atrial flutter with fixed AV block.
Atrial flutter can and waves are a bit unlikely because flutter waves sometimes cannot give rise to too much force. There is a it's fluttering. We don't consider it as a cannon wave.
Supraventricular tachycardia.
Very good. Supraventricular tachycardia. They mentioned four. Can you mention one four? One more? One more. Anyone of you? First degree heart block. Sometimes patients can be a first degree heart block so that the P wave of the succeeding QRS complex may fall in the QT segment of the previous beat. And then you can get a regular canvas. So these are the conditions where you can get regular canvas. Very good. Irregular canvas, another five conditions.
Complete heart block.
Complete heart block, very good.
Frequent premature ventricular contraction.
Very good. Irregular premature ventricular contractions, very good.
So ventricular
tachycardia. I couldn't hear you.
RV patients.
Who we have mentioned, third condition?
Ventricular tachycardia.
Ventricular tachycardia, okay, very good.
Pacing.
Thank you, pardon.
Pacing, sir. Pacing.
Very good. Excellent. Pacing. Excellent. Pacing. Very good. VVA pacing or even temporary pacing. All right. Very good. Excellent. One more. One more. Anyone of you? In both the situations you mentioned earlier before, fifth I had to add.
AVNRT, sir.
Eh?
AVNRT.
No. AVNRT will give rise to regular cannon.
Isorhythmic AV dissociation.
Yes, isorhythmic AV dissociation. And another is, I will say the first part of the statement, junctional tachycardia with
retrograde VA block.
Very good. The junctional tachycardia with retrograde block or junctional rhythm with retrograde block. They can have, but junctional tachycardia with retrograde block is more correct. Junctional tachycardia with retrograde block. So there are, we have mentioned about five conditions where there can be regular cannon waves. We have mentioned six conditions where there can be irregular cannon waves. One important point you should remember, thrill indicates that a turbulent jet is directed anteriorly. So I am going to ask a question to you. If there is a systolic thrill and at the apex, and if there is a pansystolic murmur at the apex, what is the possibility?
Mitral regurgitation.
No, mitral regurgitation will not give rise to a thrill. Have you felt a thrill in mitral regurgitation?
At max, it can give diastolic thrill.
No. Only if there is a mild mitral stenosis, but there cannot be a systolic thrill over the precordium in a patient with mitral regurgitation.
Aortic stenosis.
In case of prolapse or perforation of the mitral wall, we can get thrills.
Unlikely. See, for the thrill to happen, the turbulent jet should come anteriorly. Can you describe to me what is the relationship of cardiac embase? Which one is anterior, which one is posterior?
From posterior to anterior, it is LA, LV and aorta.
Okay.
And on the right side, it is RA, RV and pulmonary segment.
Very good. As you go from the atrium to the great vessel, the vessels become more and more anterior. Excellent. Then what next one? all the corresponding right sided chambers are anterior to the corresponding left sided chambers. R is anterior to LA, RV is anterior to LV, and pulmonary artery is anterior to aorta. So, two principles you should know. As you go from atrium to the great vessels, it becomes more and more anterior. All the corresponding right sided chambers are anterior to the corresponding left sided chambers. So, here in a patient with mitral regurgitation, that is from LV to LA, going from it is directed towards the posterior chamber. You cannot get the thrill over to the body. If you
are an aortic stenosis, can we get with a murmur at apex?
You can get a murmur at apex, but not the thrill.
VST.
Very good. Excellent. It's an apical VST. I'm quite sure at least occasionally you might have felt a thrill in a patient with acquired VST in a patient with acute myocardial infarction at the apex. So a muscular VST, sometimes in a congenital heart disease, muscular VST near the apex can have a systolic thrill. So if you are getting a systolic thrill at the apex and it is a pan-systolic murmur, you should always suspect. You can always look for radiation to the axilla, that's an additional point, but you should suspect that that could be a muscular VST. So thrill means a jet is directed anteriorly. Best example is in patients with aortic regurgitation. Can you get a thrill? Aortic regurgitation, can you get a thrill?
No, sir.
No, why?
Because it, aortic regurgitation, the jet is from the aorta to the LV.
LV.
Which is posterior.
And also it is directed towards the mitral valve. Posterior.
Mitral valve, yes.
I'm making a statement that in 10% of patients, you can have a thrill. What is this 10% of patients?
Reinfected endocarditis, perforation of the valve.
No, but you have to say the direction of the jet. As long as the direction of just is,
Sir, RSOV?
RSOV is associated with the thrill because it is not aortic regurgitation. It is because of the turbulent flow from aorta to the right ventricle. That's the commonest region. Sometimes the aortic regurgitation can be directed anteriorly towards the interventricular septum. In small percentage of cases, the direction of the jet can be towards the interventricular septum. When that happens, rarely you can get a thrill in aortic regurgitation. Not commonly, still it is rare, but still you can get. The explanation is that that is directed anteriorly towards the interventricular septum. So from the aortic valve, it goes anteriorly towards the interventricular septum, and sometimes you can get a thrill. A few important points. It's very important for this, you have to carefully look for second heart sound. In congenital heart disease diagnosis, second heart sound is in the pulmonary area is the most important clinical finding. You should be certain whether it is single, whether it is paradoxically split, whether it is wide and fixed split, whether it is wide and variable split, or whether it is a normally split one. Extremely important to carefully auscultate the pulmonary area for splitting of the second heart sound. In many situations, you can hear a single second heart sound. What are the mechanisms in which second heart sound can be single? There are about 6-7 mechanisms. Can anyone of you tell that?
Atresia of the valve.
Okay, absent valve. One of the valves is absent, pulmonary atresia. So it's only single septum. Very good.
Anterior posterior position of the great vessels.
Yes, when the aorta is anterior, not an anteroposterior positioning. When the aorta is anterior, the pulmonary valve closure sound may not be transmitted or to the precordium. Very good. Yes, three.
Very soft pulmonary component as in TOF.
Very good. Excellent. Four.
Loud one component suppressing the other component.
Like
like loud AS can suppress the loud A2 can suppress the P2.
That's what you already said about tetralogy of Hilo.
Single trunk arteriosus.
A single valve. Okay, very good. Trunk arteriosus. Very single valve.
Murmur engulfing one of the.
Very good. Murmur engulfing, especially aortic stenosis murmur can override the pulmonary valve, or the pulmonary stenosis murmur can override the aortic sound. So that sometimes you may appreciate only one sound. Very good. And the most important one you have not mentioned, and both sounds can occur together.
Electrical delay.
Eh?
Electrical delay. Right bundle branch.
No.
Overlap. Combined A2, P2.
Combined A2 and P2 occurring exactly together. What is the
condition? VST Eisenmenger.
Very good. VST Eisenmenger. So these are the multiple reasons how the second sounds can listen. And also, you can also mention in people with the thick test wall, sometimes the pulmonary component may not be reaching the test wall. So you may hear only a single sound, especially very obese people, patients with emphysema. Sometimes you may hear only one sound, not because they are having a problem, but because the aortic, the pulmonary component of the second sound is not transmitted to the precordium. Then you should also make out whether it is a normal fixing, splitting of the second heart. So I'm not going to the minor details of that. Then regarding the murmurs, when the murmur is loud, usually it indicates that it is either a valvular heart disease or a shunt lesion, atrial regurgitation, aortic regurgitation, VST, patent ductus arteriosus. So a loud murmur usually indicates a valvular heart disease or a shunt lesion. No or faint murmur. The murmur is faint or no murmur. Start thinking of primary myocardial disease like coronary disease, primary myocardial disease, systemic hypertension, storage disorders, Eisenmenger syndrome. Mitral regurgitation murmur is usually not audible at the aortic area. So in a patient with mitral regurgitation, if you are hearing a systolic murmur in the aortic area, it is unlikely to be due to mitral regurgitation. You have to give another explanation. Sometimes in patients with posterior mitral leaflet prolapse, the murmur can be radiated to the left parasternal region, but not to the right side. So if you are hearing a murmur in the aortic area, that murmur cannot be explained by a mitral regurgitation murmur. But aortic stenosis murmur can be heard at the aortic area as well as at the mitral area. There is a minor difference. As I told you, the aortic stenosis murmur is usually a high-pitched murmur with low-pitched overtones. As the murmur is transmitted towards the mitral area, the low-pitched overtones dies out, and what you hear is actually high-pitched event. That is why when you hear an aortic stenosis murmur at the apex, its character may be similar to a high-pitched blowing murmur. I told you previously also, area of maximum intensity indicates the site of the lesion. So you must always carefully look for which is the maximum intensity of the murmur. In a cyanotic patient, carefully look for ejection systolic murmur in the second left intercostal space close to sternum. Pulmonary stenosis is the commonest association or VSTPS situation where the patients can grow to older age. So patients with tetralogy of Hallow. So patients with pulmonary stenosis, if you are hearing a ejection systolic murmur in the second left intercostal space, always suspect associated pulmonary stenosis. In a cyanotic patient, if you are not hearing any murmur in the second left intercostal space and the child is young, you must always suspect that it could be pulmonary atresia. Then you should carefully auscultate over the lung fields to detect a continuous murmur, which could be due to aortopulmonary collapses. In an adult, when you find that there is no murmur, you must start suspecting it could be Eisenmenger syndrome. So, the murmur in the second pulmonary area is the most important auscultatory finding that you should carefully look for in all patients of cyanotic heart disease. It may indicate a VSTPS situation. Presence of trill indicates that just the abnormal jet is anteriorly directed. That is why you get trill in ventricular septal defect. It is from LV to RV. You can get a trill in mitral stenosis because jet is flowing from the posterior left atrium to the anterior left ventricle. You can get a trill in pulmonary stenosis because the blood is flowing from right ventricle to the pulmonary artery, which is anterior. You can get a thrill in aortic stenosis because the blood is flowing from LV to aorta, which is anterior. And sometimes you can get a thrill in atrial ductus arteriosus. That is, blood is flowing from aorta, which is posterior, to the left pulmonary artery, which is anterior. In mitral regurgitation, thrill, I would say that it's unlikely. That is because the direction of the abnormal jet is from anterior to posterior. Sometimes people have described that you may be able to feel a thrill in the infrascapular area, but not over the precordium. A presence of thrill usually indicates that the jet is anteriorly directed. Sometimes you can get a thrill when the murmur is generated because of the turbulence when it is very superficial, especially when there is a turbulence in the RV outflow or even in RV body. RV body and RV outflow are very, very superficial, and sometimes you may get a thrill there, as can occur in ruptured sinus of valsalva. So, presence of thrill always indicate that the abnormal jet is directed anterior.
Sir, MS thrill can also be there, sir.
Beg your pardon?
MS and TS can also have thrill, sir.
Yeah, because there the turbulence is not very much, but you can get a thrill because it is directed anteriorly. Because blood is flowing from left atrium to left ventricle, the direction of the jet is anterior. So you can get a thrill. So thrill can be felt in mitral stenosis, but not in mitral regurgitation. Of course, in tricuspid stenosis, thrill is very unusual because the velocity of flow is not very high. So the turbulence is not very high. So very unlikely, but theoretically, yes. Finally, when you write the cardiac diagnosis, these 5 points should be there. One, etiology, morbid anatomy, altered physiology, how severe is the problem? Are there any complications? When you write the diagnosis in a congenital heart disease, it should be etiology, congenital heart disease. When you go to morbid anatomy, you should also mention whether it is dextrocardia or levocardia. Then you should describe about the abnormal lesion, total limb canal defect, VSTPS, whatever it is, nephrology of canal, whatever it is. Altered physiology, right to left shunt, or admixture lesion, or transposition physiology. How severe is the problem? Is it a severe tetralogy of fellow, moderate tetralogy of fellow, mild tetralogy of fellow, and are there any complications? So if you try to put the diagnosis under these 5 headings, you will not miss anything. You have to describe, complications can be atrial fibrillation, pulmonary arterial hypertension, heart failure, both right and left heart failure, or embolic episode, all those can be complications. So, try to put the cardiac diagnosis under these 5 things. Etiology, morbid anatomy, altered physiology, how severe is the problem, are there any complications. Congenital heart disease, you should always also mention whether it is levocardia or dextrocardia, and you should always mention in the etiology itself whether it is a cyanotic or an acyanotic engineering process. I think I have tried to give you a stepwise approach to the clinical diagnosis, and we have taken slightly longer time. I thank you for your attention, and if you have got any doubts, you can ask now.
Sir, one small doubt, sir.
Okay.
Sir, in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, the peaking correlates with the severity.
Peaking does not correlate with severity always, because see, it is a late diastolic murmur. Many factors come into the production of the abnormality of the mitral valve. Sometimes in a patient with the obstruction is not only due to the hypertrophic myocardium, it is also partly because of the abnormal movement of the abnormal mitral valve. The systolic anterior motion of the mitral valve also contributes. So you cannot always say that, in a way you can say that there is a late peaking also may indicate, but I will not vouch for that. I have not read that, so I can't be certain.
Sir, in patients with atrial fibrillation, the percussion can be done, sir?
What do you mean by the question? I couldn't follow that.
If the patient is having atrial fibrillation, the percussion part of the examination can be done, or it can be avoided?
I don't think there is any, of course, percussion. Many examiners don't ask you to percuss, but percussion can still be done whether it is atrial fibrillation or not. That is not a problem. You can definitely percuss. You percuss the apical region, whether the dullness corresponds to the palpated apex beat. You can always percuss the second right and the left intercostal space, which has nothing to do with atrial fibrillation. And you can get an idea about the dilated right atrium, which may be dilated in a patient with atrial fibrillation. Looking for dullness beyond the right parasternal region in a patient with dilated right atrium. So that can be done.
Yes.
Any other clarifications required?
Sir, low cardiac output features, sir, if you can tell again once, sir, fatigue and what else?
Beg your pardon?
Sir, low cardiac output features that you had explained, one was fatigue. What else features for low cardiac output, sir?
Low cardiac output features are because of the reduced output, cardiac output. So, they can have cold extremities, they can have reduced blood supply going to the kidneys, can result in urine formation becomes less. The patient will be lethargic because of the low cardiac output, because of the blood flowing to the exercising muscles are reduced. And most of these patients, because of the low cardiac output, they will have increased left ventricular and diastolic volume. That can result in elevated left ventricular diastolic pressure, left atrial congestion, and they can have gradually they start developing exertional breathlessness. Initially, their main symptom will be mostly fatigue and tiredness. Subsequently, they can start developing symptom of lung congestion. They will have usually low volume pulse also.
Okay, sir.
Any other doubts? The next class, we will have a case discussion, virtual case discussion. I want a volunteer. What is anybody who would like to volunteer to discuss a case? Discussion will be based on what I have told you. You will not have any problem. I will also help you. And after discussing 4 or 5 cases, and you can apply this method of stepwise diagnosis, it becomes extremely easy to come to a diagnosis. Volunteers? You are all good boys, good students. The volunteers.
So we will do spontaneous discussions, sir, next time, sir.
No, no, you cannot have spontaneous discussion. One person has to discuss the case, then only there is a continuity. What is your name? What is your name?
Sir, Sunil, I'll be appearing this Friday, sir. So, Thursday. So, Friday I won't be there, sir.
Oh, okay, okay, okay. So, okay. Can there be somebody who is not appearing? Is Ashok there? Ashok? Somebody who is willing to discuss. Because case has to be discussed, then only you will get an idea how to approach a cardiovascular system disease. There are many people who answered the question, who seems to know the cardiac physiology reasonably well, can easily discuss the case. Anybody from Lissy Hospital? Okay, because somebody should discuss, then only we can have a real case discussion. Okay, then I will ask any one of you to come forward and discuss the case, because usually we will start with a straightforward simple case and then gradually build up the complexity. And so the next week's discussion should be based on a simple case. So there should not be any problem. Okay, so we'll close the session. If there are no more doubts, we'll close it. Any doubts to be cleared?
No, thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, doctors. We'll meet up next Friday around the same time, 7 to 9. Thank you, Dr. Manjuran.
Okay, so next time when we come, I think we should get a volunteer to discuss the case so that he learns and others also can contribute. Okay, Jirai? Okay, fine.
Yes, sir. Fine. Yes, sir.
Okay.
So can I stop recording?
Yeah. Stop recording.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.